This is the number one podcast, whether you're looking to flip, wholesale, or buy rentals. Here at Future Flipper, we transform lives through real estate investing. And now, your host, Brian Davila.
All right, Khang. Well, I'm really excited to have you on the Future Flipper podcast. You know, you're a big time real estate investor. Where are you based out of?
Seattle, Washington, but I live in a little small town called Bellingham.
Okay, perfect. All right, so we don't have a long time. So I guess, do you want to give us a quick intro into your backstory?
Sure, man. I mean, first of all, Brian, I want to say thank you so much for having me on, man. It's such an honor. And, you know, Pineda is doing some big, great things, and so are you. And, man, I look up to Pineda a lot, man. The guy is definitely an inspiration to me.
Nice, perfect.
But man, yeah, you know, for those of you who don't know, my name is Khang, also known as King Khang. I was born and raised in Vietnam. I came to America at the age of 9, dropped out of high school when I was 17, got into real estate at the age of 27, and I started out as fix and flip, and that didn't go as planned. So I discovered wholesaling, went all in on wholesaling, and I became a millionaire when I was pretty much 32, man. And
dang.
And now I'm here, you know, launching social media and just trying to catch up with Pineda.
Nice, dude. Well, there's so much in there I want to touch on. Yeah. But all right, first part, why did you drop out of high school?
You know, man, one, I got bullied extremely hard when I was in high school. You know, English is my second language. And at the time, I was extremely insecure about myself, my physical, like kind of my look and everything like that. And I knew I was just not smart in school, dude. I knew I wasn't going to go to college after I graduated from high school. And I see other people that graduated with a, you know, with a diploma, and they were still going to work at a regular job and work at a factory. And I say, you know what? If I don't have any plan to go to college after high school, what's the use of a diploma, right? I mean, dude, like school in America is extremely easy. All you need to do is show up. You get a D, you pass. But not in my country. My country, you got to take a test. Your parents got to pay for the test, etc. But I just knew that school wasn't for me, man. I just knew that I wasn't the book smart. So I decided, you know what? I'm going to get an early start on my life. I'm going to drop out. I don't know what the heck I was going to do. My parents obviously was very pissed off. But I told my mom, man. I told my mom, I said, you know what? I have the work ethic. So I'm willing to grind from the bottom up. I don't care if I have to go be a janitor or whatever it is, man. And I just knew it wasn't for me. And I decided to drop out and take the road of real world and real life.
Got it. And then, so I actually dropped out of high school also.
Wow.
So yeah, around the 9th grade, I knew that it wasn't for me. I felt like I was wasting my time. I started working when I was like 15, and then I got two jobs by the time I was like 16. And then,
dang.
Yeah, kind of very similar road as you.
Wow, man.
But, all right. So I guess, let's touch on the real estate journey. So you started off flipping.
Yes.
And then why did you transition into wholesaling? Are you still flipping? Like how did that go?
Yeah, man. So we got into real estate at the age of 27. And the reason why is because of the wife, dude. You know, she wanted something where we'll create financial freedom, you know, building, obviously getting passive income, rental property and all that. And the only way that she knew at the time was, you know, real estate. And when I got in real estate, man, I didn't know anything. I didn't know what laminate flooring is. I didn't know what vinyl window is. I didn't know what shingle is. I didn't know anything, not just about the construction. I didn't even know the term, right? And we just decided just to jump in. And I started out fix and flip because I was like, you know what? Why wholesale? Why make 5 to 10K when I can make 30 to 40 to 50K on a flip? But I didn't know a flip of per potential profit of 50K can turn to a negative 5K. So, you know, I think at the time, man, I was going, Brian, I was going too fast, too quick. So you got to understand, I was trying to learn, right? And I was doing all the marketing myself, right? Getting off market deals. And I was also didn't know anything about construction. I didn't know anything about, you know, systems. I didn't know anything about team, but I was trying to chase after, like I was competing with other investors in my market, man.
Yeah.
So I wasn't focused on my lane, my game. But I was like, hey, you know what? Why am I only doing one flip when other investors are doing 3 to 4 flip at the same time. Mm-hmm. So instead of focus on the profit, I focus on number of deals. Like my ego took in, and yeah, man, I was trying to go too fast, too quick. About 4 years in, I was doing 4 flip. I got $1.5 million tied up. I pretty much tap out. Like I couldn't get the money anymore. There's no more. Like I had to finish my property has to sold for me to get the profit back and to reinvest.
Yeah.
And I think, dude, I watched one of Pineda video, and he said this was one of his mistakes, and it's also one of my mistakes. The money I had in the bank, I thought that was like the cash that I can use on whatever, but that was not. That was for me to pay the contractor. That was for me to pay for the material. And when all of a sudden the bills just hit you all at once,
all of a sudden
I see my bank account like a couple hundred thousand going down to like 10,000 or 20,000. And dude, I freak out.
Yeah.
And dude, it was really bad. I was the bit, and the time where I was like, dude, so I also owe money on taxes. So I was like, do I pay Uncle Sam first or do I pay my mentor? So I have to choose. And dude, I choose to pay my mentor, and and I haven't shared this on my social media, but I choose to pay him because I promised him. And dude, I got Uncle Sam coming after me, man. So anyways, but we got that taken care of. I discovered wholesaling because I couldn't flip anymore. So one of my local investors said, hey, Khang, why don't you look into wholesaling? Because you're so good at finding deals. You're so good at negotiating with the seller. Mm-hmm. And that's exactly what happened. I found this deal. Boom, put it under contract. Found a buyer in 2 days. Closed it within like 7 to 10 days. And boom, made $28,000 on a wholesale. No fixing, no buying, no stress, no headaches. And dude, 28,000, man. And then I said, dude, I'm going to shut down my whole fix and flip operation. I'm going all in on what I'm good at, which is wholesaling, stress-free, headaches-free, and boom. And I just use all my wholesaling money, man, just to now get myself back up again and just pay for all the construction and just get the whole fix and flip game done.
That's crazy. So yeah, it was pretty much you were over leveraged.
Yeah.
And I actually, same thing in 2020, I paid for Ryan's mentorship and I wanted to flip 50 houses. So I did the math. I was like, okay, I need to buy 6 houses a month because I wanted to buy them and close them in 2020. Wow. And then same as you, by March, I started this in January. By March, I had 12 houses. And at one point I had $10,000 in my bank account.
Woo! Yeah. So that's scary. Like,
yeah. I literally was so stressed out. Every time I would go to eat, I would just be like, oh my God, like I shouldn't even be spending this money. Like I was like on the brink of bankruptcy. So I've actually been there before, but, you touched on so much stuff right there that I guess the first part I want to touch on is you said, you know, you had the choice of mentorship or Uncle Sam.
Correct.
Why did you decide to do a mentorship if you were already in like financial hardship?
Because I promised my mentor. Mm-hmm. And to me, reputation and your word as a man or a woman, whatever it is, dude, is extremely important. You say you're going to do it, you're going to do it. I didn't promise Uncle Sam anything, right? So, yeah, man. And my, it was kind of on the news, kind of where I'm at too, man. It was bad. But I choose to pay my mentor because that's what I told him I would do. And delay on Uncle Sam. But we end up, got him pay as well. And everything is good. This was like, I think six years ago.
Wow. Do you think you would be where you're at without paying for that mentorship?
Man, you know, no, I wouldn't. And even though my journey, like I wouldn't, man, because I struggled for 6 months, Brian. I struggled for 6 months. I try to do everything. You know, I said, you know what? Why spend so much money on a mentor? Dude, I can figure this out. Like I can figure this out. And I try that, dude. I watch all the YouTube channel. I go to the real estate seminars. Like I go to my network. I did everything. 6 months in, I didn't even get a deal. And this is what I tell myself. I said, Khang, do you want the next 6 months of your life to be the same as the last six? Which means you're still trying to figure it out. Mm-hmm. And I said, you know what? I had enough. I can always make the money back, but I will never get my time back. And I do not want to see the next 6 months to be like my last. Mm-hmm. So I decided to go to this. I went to the seminars, got the mentorship, pay for it, dude. And then flew him out the whole 9 yards, got him first class and everything. pay for his hotel and everything like that. and with him coming out, man, and just within 3 days, got my first deal. That's my first fix and flip. We did really good on my first one. Made 50 G's off of my, took us about 4 months to rehab. I didn't do the work, right? Uh-huh. We hired general contractor. Everything was good, man, because the first property, dude, it was cosmetic. Mm-hmm. And I was just focusing on that one house.
Yeah.
Nothing else, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it was a success. Made 50 G's. And I was like, oh, yeah, baby. Lon and I, dude, Brian, Lon and I, we were in the car driving home after we sold the house. We're like, oh, hell yeah, we're going to get rich.
That's funny. I guess, do you still pay for mentorship, or now what do you do about that?
Yeah, so I don't me and my mentor, we still have a good relationship, man. It's like getting in the door, continue to build that relationship. And now, mm-hmm. you know, we're at the same real estate mastermind. So now I do pay for a mastermind called Collective Genius, which is CG. Mm-hmm. So I pay there to go there and to network with other big individuals, because I understand now the power of mentorship, the power of networking with other people that are where you want it to go.
Mm-hmm. Got it.
Yeah.
Okay. Another part I wanted to ask you about that you touched on earlier was, you know, you grew up, you're bullied, all that stuff.
Yep.
Same with me. When I grew up, I was very introverted. I don't know. I think because I was from Puerto Rico and I spoke Spanish, and then I moved to Las Vegas and I didn't speak full English. I had to go to English as your second language class. I didn't have confidence. How did you build your confidence?
Man. Woo, dude. And you guys, confident don't happen like overnight. It's not like all of a sudden you change and then you're like, oh, I'm confident. Throughout my whole entire teen, up into my late 20s, Brian, I was extremely insecure. Insecure where I will never go to the mall because there's too many people there. But what's weird, Brian, is I'm not an introvert. Dude, like when I hang out with my friends and family, dude, I'm the one that talks the most. Like, I'm extremely outgoing.
Yeah.
But because of my insecurity, I was so concerned about the way that I look. And obviously when I was in high school, man, I have so much acne. And it just really destroyed my confidence, man. And, when you go to high school, when you get kids bully and make fun of your English, they make fun of the way you look. They call me, you know, my eyes, like all kinds of stuff. And how I got over it, Brian, is because of my wife. And honestly, dude, there's two people I got to thank. Number one is God. I wouldn't be here without God, dude, because there were time in my life where I was so down, where everything was just black, where I didn't know there was a way out. But God was always there for me, man. He always showed me the way.
Mm-hmm.
And number two is the wife. I wouldn't be here without the wife, dude. And she's the one that gave me the confidence and the belief to become the person I am today. And the person I am today, Brian, is actually who I was deep down inside when I was a teen.
Mm-hmm.
But so when I got with the wife, I had to, and she said, Khang, listen, you cannot be like this if we want to live our dream life. Like, you got to man up. Dude, yeah, dude, she's a badass. She said, Khang, you got to man up. Because who you are today will not get us to where we needed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And I just have to choose, man. Like, continue to suffer with the life like this.
Mm-hmm.
Or get over it.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not going to get better. Get over it. This is your skin. This is exactly how you're going to look. You ain't going to change. I'm not going to get plastic surgery, right? So it was slowly. And Brian, what really helped me, man, is because we have this little kiosk in the mall, and that was our first little entry into becoming a business owner.
Mm-hmm.
We were selling hair extension kiosk in the mall, and my wife said, Khang, I need your help. I cannot do this alone. So I was working at a factory, 5 o'clock in the morning. I would come home. I remember my first day going into the mall and selling hair extension. And I remember the first day I went in there, Brian, I drove back home, cry with the wife. But eventually I was just taking it one day at a time, man. I go in there for a few hours. I feel good. I stay. I don't feel good. I call the wife. I comes home. But just one day at a time.
Mm-hmm.
And I think over a period about 6 to 7 months. Now Now I'm feeling better. I'm a little bit more comfortable. But dude, to be where I'm at getting on social media, putting myself in front of a camera. You got to understand, I hate taking pictures. I hate being on video. And anybody took picture of me or get video of me when right in my family, and if I see it, Brian, I would cry. And I would make them take it off. Really? Yes, that was how, dude, it was really bad, bro. And anyways, dude, it took me years to now where I'm really comfortable where, dude, it, like now, nothing you can say, Brian, will offend me or will make me sad. Yeah.
If you're listening to this podcast, then my guess is you're interested in real estate investing. Some of you are just starting out while others are trying to scale their business to the next level. But the problem is with so much information out there, most people don't know which program or coach to trust. Well, I'm a bit biased, but I believe my company, Future Flipper, can help you get to the next level. We've coached thousands of students from all over the world on how to build their real estate investing business. It doesn't matter whether you want to flip, wholesale, or buy rentals. Our coaching program has everything you need to become a great investor. There are many things that we include with coaching, but to give you a few examples, you're going to get an accountability coach. These are people that have had success in their own business, and they want to make sure that you achieve success in yours. We also have all of our documents, our systems, and processes that I've used to buy hundreds of homes. You can copy and paste them directly into your own business. And we have events where you get to meet me, top-level guest speakers, and other students who are crushing it. My students do deals with each other, and I personally do deals with them too. In fact, at a recent event, I just honored over 20 people in our program that made over $1 million in the last year. So if you want to grow your real estate business, head over to futureflipper.com and apply for a call with our team. The call is completely free, and they can help point you in the right direction whether you work with us or not. So go to futureflipper.com and book your call today.
So I guess if we try to break it down into like practical steps, I guess number one, you were saying take it day by day. You're not going to freaking turn into this rock star overnight. So you have to understand, you have to slowly build. A second part you touched on was faith, your relationship with God. Was there a specific verse in the Bible, or was there a specific prayer? Was there a sign from God? Was there something?
Yeah, man. So, you know, I pray every single day, and I don't share this a lot on my social media because I don't want to get into, you know, people saying, hey, Khang, you religious and all that. But yeah, man, I pray every single day, man. Every single morning, you know, people always ask me, so Khang, what is your morning ritual? And the only thing that I know that I would do the same every morning is I get down on my knees and I just pray to baby Jesus. I just pray to baby Jesus, man. And then after that, I obviously go on my day. But there's many dark days in my life. And I think that the one was me getting into the whole fix and flip where that was so scary for me. Like once again, just like you, Brian, I almost had to choose to file bank. It was so scary. I got down on my knees. I cry and I pray and I say, God, show me the way. And there's something, there's a voice or I don't know what to say, bro, but something said, Khang, do what you fear.
Yeah.
I pick up the phone. I call my electricians for him to come out to look at the property. And I don't think I have time to get into that, but I was so afraid to make that phone call. But that phone call, dude, is what set me free. Everything was fine.
Yeah.
And I pray for 4 days. I cry myself to sleep. But anyways, yeah.
Got it. All right. So you have so much knowledge. It's crazy how you can put three sentences together and there's so much, but pretty much I'm gonna put it all together. So if you want to build your confidence, three easy steps would be take it day by day, have faith in God, and do what you fear. So if you know you're scared of something, do it anyways.
Yep.
Okay, so I've been following you for a little bit and
Yeah,
a few years.
Dude, I'm honored.
And I've noticed a switch in you. When I first started watching you, you were very like, don't spend money, you know, be frugal, be cheap.
Yep.
And then now I see you living it up a little bit. I see the Ferrari, congratulations.
Thank you.
Tips. I see spending a little, you bought, I think, your mother-in-law house.
Yes. Bought.
Okay. So what switched? What happened?
Gotcha, Brian. And I think that's a great question. And I don't think I have changed at all. It's just that people misunderstood my message. My message was live below your mean, live within 10 to 15% of what you make. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is, you know, and I say this all the time is, dude, don't try to be a bowler when you got no dollar, baby. Yeah. I could have bought this Ferrari 3 years ago, but throughout mm-hmm. my whole entire life, Brian, one word that got me here, dude, delay mm-hmm. instant gratification. Mm-hmm. And that's it. You know, I talk about not cheap, dude. Like it's not about being cheap. It's being smart with your money. You got to be mm-hmm. frugal. So mm-hmm. if you can buy a Ferrari now, and if it's only 10 to 15% of what you make, so if you can make $300,000 in 1 month, you, mm-hmm. my friend, and if you can do that consistently and stack mm-hmm. away at least $1 million in the bank, mm-hmm. you, my friend, can go get that Ferrari. So because mm-hmm. someone just commented and said, you know, because now I can buy 10 of those Ferrari, but I choose to buy one and I'm mm-hmm. happy with the entry level. So, dude, I'm all about the good life, health, wealth, love and happiness. Fly mm-hmm. private. Go. Exotic vacation. I'm not one of those millionaire where, dude, you stack away so much money that you're afraid to go out for a nice dinner. You're afraid to buy a nice car. You're afraid to buy designer clothes. I'm not one of those. I'm a millionaire where you make the money, dude. It's time. Money is for you to enjoy and for you to buy, for you to enjoy. It's not for you to be slave to the money. But people mm-hmm. get my message wrong. You know, dude. You gotta always save and reinvest. Save. We reinvest back into our business to now where, you know, I think we crank out about around 350 or 360 a month. Mm-hmm. And I told myself until I make what I make in a month, then I'll go buy a Ferrari. Mm-hmm. So it's not about just being cheap, dude, because there's no point of making all this money and not spend.
100%.
You just understand. See, people get mixed up, Brian. It's like, you know, it's 10 to 15. If you can spend only 10 to 15% of what you make and just focus on increasing your income. So if you focus on increasing your income, dude, how much you can spend a month, dude, there's no limit. If you want to spend $100,000 a month, make $1 million. That's all I got to say. That's my goal. Yep.
All right. So we have 8 minutes left. I want to ask you two important questions.
Sure.
You mentor people, you have students. You know, I work with Ryan Pineda at Future Flipper. We mentor people. We have students.
Yes.
What do you think is the biggest difference between the people that make it and the people that don't?
Dude, one word, mindset, period. Mindset. That's it.
Why? What does that mean?
So you see, to me, the mindset between a winner and a loser. So it doesn't matter how smart you are. It doesn't matter if you have a college degree. It doesn't matter if you're born in a rich or a poor family. It doesn't matter your nationality. It doesn't matter anything. It all mm-hmm. comes to mindset. And mm-hmm. and what I mean by mindset is the people that have the proper mindset, dude, mm-hmm. they're willing to do whatever it takes. They don't make excuses, right? Mm-hmm. Like they just don't make excuses. They know they have to grind. They know they have to make the sacrifice. They know if they want to make more, they need to do and become more than who they are today. Mm-hmm. And the people that have the wrong mindset, dude, they'll get into a program or a mentorship or whatever it is. Oh, they're like, oh, this person scammed. This is not working. That's not working. Like they blame on everything except for them. Mm-hmm. Dude, everything work. The question is, do you work? And most people don't.
So I guess if I break that down into actionable steps, it would be pretty much take accountability, 100% accountability.
Absolutely.
Like Grant Cardone says in, I think in 10X, he said, You have to take responsibility when you win, and you have to take responsibility when you don't win.
Absolutely. And I think,
go ahead.
Yeah. And I think Gary Vee also said that as well.
Okay. So yeah. So pretty much extreme accountability. I live by that also. When I don't hit my goals, I don't look at my employees. I don't look at the market. I don't say, hey, it's too competitive.
Yep.
I obviously didn't do something right, and I need to figure out what it is and then change it. Look for an excuse, not look to change markets, not look to, you know, change industries, just figure out what I did wrong. Okay. Last part we'll touch on, last 5 minutes. I see that you're getting into some sort of like NFT project.
Yes.
What is that?
So NFT is a non-fungible token. And I think I believe in NFT as much as Pineda is. Mm-hmm. And I think NFT will be the future, believe it or not. And it's here to stay. And I think mm-hmm. that, you know, business owner, entrepreneur, influencer, eventually is going to create their own NFT. NFT, what it is pretty much it give you an exclusive, right, pass or ticket or whatever it is into this basically into a network, into a program, into a mastermind, but it's exclusive. Like there is no more. And the best way I can explain NFT is, for example, you know, if you like Starbucks and Starbucks comes out with 10 NFT and they say, hey, you know what? Whoever have these 10 NFT, right? You will get free Starbucks for life. You can drink any day, every day. And there are only 10 of those. And what's so crazy about NFT, unlike like, okay, let's say Pineda has an event, right? I know he has an event, Future Flipper,
yeah,
right? And what if he said, hey, there's only X amount of this tickets. There's no more. You have the ticket. You can come to my event. You don't have the ticket. I'm sorry. You can't even pay money to get in. And that's what makes it so exclusive and worth so much. And the thing is that the people that don't even like Starbucks. So let's just say, Brian, you don't like Starbucks, but I like Starbucks. You happen to buy those. You happen to buy one of that 10 ticket. Well, guess what, my friend? Now, since there's only 10 of those, you can sell that. Right? So you can sell that and make a profit. So influencer, what if they come out with, hey, you know what? You come and hang out with me and my team, whatever it is. Here is the ticket, right? You need to get this NFT. And even if I, hey, Brian, let's say, right? Let's say I know you have a big following, know that people love you. Your audience is going to buy this, but I'm not going to be a part of it. Guess what? I will still invest and buy your NFT because I know I can flip it for a profit.
So I don't know if you've already came out with the details, like what, can you talk about your project or what your plans are?
Sure. Absolutely, Brian. And thank you so much for bringing this up, man. Yeah. So I am going to launch my own NFT project, and I think we're pushing it back to sometime early May. It was late April, but we're pushing it back because we make a couple of changes. Definitely want this to be like, I want it to be perfect. I want when we're launched, like the investor, the shareholder in the NFT, like you guys are going to get exactly what I promise. But we are going to mint only X amount of this. And so one of the perks is, you know, I'm going to do an event once a year for 3 years, only to the NFT holder. So if you have the, ticket, you can come. I'll bring some of my multimillionaire friends to come on to network. Obviously I would love to, get Pineda on the stage as well. You know, and I like, and then you get exclusive into my mentorship. We're also working on like something where it gives you passive income, where as a shareholder of the NFT, we're planning to do some kind of a private funding, like an ecosystem private funding, man. So basically, if you have the NFT, right, we're going to put, so the money that's going to come from the NFT is not coming from you. It's coming from people that are selling and flipping TMC NFT, right? And then that money, I decided I'm going to split 50-50% with the community. So 50% will go back into the ecosystem, right? And then whoever it is that a shareholder of the NFT. So let's just say, hey, Brian, you'll be like, hey, you know what? I got this project that comes up or this flip I want to come up, man, that I want to buy, right? So what you're going to do is you're going to submit your ticket and then the community will vote. And then you get to basically now lend from the ecosystem. And then we'll charge you interest on it. And that interest that you pay will go back into, and then it gets distributed to all the shareholder. But we are still working on that. And we're trying to talk with an attorney, trying to figure out the legal and making sure that's all legit. But yeah.
Nice, dude. I guess what inspired you to do that, or where did this come from?
I gotta say Gary V, man. I mean, you know, seeing Gary V launching his NFT project, seeing that he builds such a community, because I really want to narrow down and just focus on the people that believe and invest in me. If they invest in me, I want to invest back into them. So I want just to build a solid community, man, where we can go in there like Neo Tokyo. When I was able to join Neo Tokyo, everybody that was in the community, dude, everybody was reaching out, helping you. How can I help you grow your business? Right? And everything like that. So I just want to build a solid, small network of people where we can help each other grow, scale, and make money together, man. That's pretty much it.
All right, Khang. Well, thank you so much for coming on the Future Club podcast. If people want to reach out to you or they want to follow you, where's the best place to go?
Yes. So I'm on Instagram. I'm on Twitter. I'm also on TikTok. But you just go to at Real King Khang, K-I-N-G-K-R-E-A-L-K-I-N-G-K-H-A-N-G. Or you can join my Discord channel. Currently, we have over 21,000 members on there already. I mean, I really want to bring some of the most driven and ambitious entrepreneurs on the planet under one roof, so you can network completely for free right now. Just go to tmcnftproject.com, and I look forward to seeing you on there.
Perfect. Well, all right, guys, thank you for listening to this podcast. Make sure to subscribe, like, and share. See you guys on the next episode. Peace.
Ryan, thank you so much.
Dude, quick picture.
Yes.
Dude, you killed it, bro. So much value. And like, I could sit there and break down every little sentence and just like, you were dropping so much value. So I really appreciate it. So
Ryan, thank you so much, man. Such an honor. Honestly, dude, it's such an honor to be here. Thank you so much.
All right, brother. Good seeing you.
Yep.
Have a good day.
Later, bro.
Bye.